We would like to invite our third speaker, Mr. Kevin Flanagan, to give his speech. What he's going to share with us is really, really interesting because he has done a lot of research on high-rise timber structure with the University of Cambridge. Now, we don't normally think of timber structures with used in high-rise structures, so this is going to be a very interesting talk to me personally and probably to a lot of us out there. So Mr. Kevin has also asked everyone to participate in his speech later. You guys can come on forward and look at the models being displayed on stage. So everyone can participate, come on up and have a look. So without further ado, let's put our hands together for Mr. Kevin Flanagan.
Adults keep saying that we owe it to the young people to give them hope. But I don't want your hope. I don't want you to be hopeful. I want you to panic. I want you to feel the fear I feel every day. And then I want you to act. I want you to act as if you were in a crisis, because it is.
So that's the beginning of the talk. It's unfortunate the minister couldn't stay because this is going to be illustrating some of the very real-world problems, but also the solutions to much having to do with climate change, the reduction of the creation of zero-energy buildings, and the edge, which I'll show you as well. We may be running over, but I'll be very, very fast. So we can discuss this later, but also a lot of this is online. So we're PLP in London. And PLP, for me at least, means people. So this is where we concentrate. This is the project called The Edge, the world's most sustainable building. But also, it happened to be sociologically very important because it was the first time that integrated the way that people worked, lived, and interacted with mobile apps. Zero energy building.
Welcome to The Edge. This is certifiably the greenest office building in the world. But that just might be the least interesting part about it, because The Edge in Amsterdam is also possibly the most connected office space in the world. Working at The Edge is insane. It all starts with a smartphone app developed by the building's main tenant, the consulting firm Deloitte. When you arrive at The Edge, a camera recognizes you by your license plate for automatic access. And because it's the Netherlands, there are chargers available for electric cars. Inside, things start to get interesting because you don't have a desk. No one here does. Workspaces are assigned to you based on your schedule for the day. You have options. A work booth, a meeting room, what they call a concentration room, a sitting desk, a standing desk, a balcony desk. You can even just hang out in the sun-filled atrium all day. This concept is called hot desking, and it's what allows Deloitte to have 2,500 workers, but less than half as many desks at its Dutch headquarters. The app knows your preferences, and when you arrive at your workspace, the lights dim or brighten based on your stored settings. And any of the building's massive flat screens can be instantly paired with an iPhone or a laptop. So what makes all this possible? The LED light panels developed by Philips specifically for The Edge are actually powered by low voltage Ethernet cables, which means every light in the building becomes its own internet connected data hub with 28,000 sensors that makes the building and its users smarter.
The building becomes a very important part of who we are and what we want to be, and we actually seen in recruitment that more people are now spontaneously coming to Deloitte because they want to work in this building.
Oh yeah, and then there's these. The building has solar on the roof and on the south-facing wall, enough to power the building and all of the electric cars, computers, and smartphones used by its employees. And those employees are kept warm by two enormous boreholes tunneling more than 400 feet down beneath the building. During the summer, The Edge pumps warm water deep into the aquifer, where it sits insulated until it can be sucked back out in the winter to warm the building. Outside, there are beehive towers and bat homes to support the local pollinators. And even the rainwater is collected to flush the toilets and irrigate the gardens.
We are planning to build a lot more buildings like these. And the next one will be smarter, and the one after that will be smarter as well. And we won't stop until all cities in the world are filled with buildings that are intelligent and that are not using any energy anymore. In the end, we will actually need less buildings in the world, but the buildings that are there will be used in a better way, will be more efficient, and will be using a lot less energy than in the past.
Sometimes the edge just feels like it's showing off, and some of the app functionality isn't quite ready for prime time yet. But most of the time, this is all running seamlessly in the background. It's maybe the most fully realized vision of the Internet of Things the world has ever seen. Another day at the edge comes to an end. A custom security robot that looks a bit like R2-D2 wakes up and begins its patrols. Now, if only the app could automatically come conjure up a nice dinner recipe, maybe provide all the fresh ingredients at the end of the day to get you cooking. No surprise, the Edge has that too. Bon appetit.
So I'm showing this really because 3 years on, what we found is that the young people of today, millennials, are actually use the building in a completely different way. They're not using the app as it was intended. They're using their own apps and have changed the way the building works in a fundamental way. They actually tend to sit in the central space, which seems like an open space. And in terms of recruitment, the company saves about $5 million a year, or every 5 years, because they don't have to retrain people. People stick to the company. Now, I've been invited really to talk about timber towers, which we're doing as a study with Cambridge University. And when we talk about timber or wood, we really also can be talking about bamboo, because that's under study as well. So in terms of the discussion here today, we've got a lot of work around the world. We've been presenting and have been exhibiting throughout the world as well, not just simply in the past, but in London today, there are two exhibitions simultaneously going on. We look at AI, of course, artificial intelligence, when we begin to study our buildings, because we want to know how people are going to be using them. We are trying to make people happy. And because they're happy, they will have an affinity to the company, affinity to their work-life balance in a way that is unheard of at present. So when we talk about smart buildings like the Edge, we're also thinking about smart cities, how to integrate these special new techniques and new sense of comfort to people's lives. But we're also talking about green cities, because you probably know that the WELL standards are now being incorporated into a lot of major international standards for buildings and design. But what we're really beginning to find has a lot to do with using this material, oddly enough, by confluence of the study of this material and its introduction in 2005, we're finding that looking at the materials that are used in buildings anew can actually improve people's health. So wouldn't that be great if you felt better after a day's work than when you entered the building? So there are benefits in such a way. We love forests. Actually, if you consider it, we have a symbiotic relationship to forests. The fact that we breathe out CO2 and it absorbs CO2, it changes the humidity of temperatures in rooms just naturally, even if it was a timber panel. And because people love it so much, and it absorbs CO2 typically, and also absorbs humidity and changes the humidity within a room, it's found that rooms themselves could be made smaller, according to Katera. So it has some economic impact as well, if you can integrate it. But also, of course, trees in cities are a good thing, as you know. In a lot of Asian cities, they've planted many trees by roadways. Architecture can be a provocation for positive change, and we're thinking really about architecture as an idea, not as a physical built form. And we're also looking at how structures can become more efficient and optimize their characteristics, which we can more easily do now that we're using AI and computing. These are just some slides having to do with the way the climate is likely to be changing in the next few years. Here's the world's smartest man telling us that it's irreversible, potentially. And what is the real problem is that we're many on the planet producing many things all at once in a way that's uncharacteristic to the species. So we've really entered a new age where half the world's population exists in cities, and in about 30 years, about two-thirds of the population of the world will be living in cities, particularly the 150 cities of the world will double in population. So we have a huge demand for residential, particularly, and we have a very high demand for new ideas. So we're thinking new innovations, very important. We love challenges, just as you do. It's a natural case with the human species that challenges are good. It brings people together towards a common cause. And we think of creativity as essential to bringing forward these new ideas. And that is really based on trust. So when we look at creating new ideas, we look at asking our colleagues for assistance on how to move ideas forward, how to create new materials potentially, how to use those materials. It becomes something that is really global now, particularly for this study into timber. We also need an investment in people with ideas, and also this idea that smart cities, well cities, need to be CO2 economies, essentially. When we look at London, about 150 new buildings in the east part of London, all of them are going to be concrete. But if one in three were made out of timber, they would have a zero CO2 footprint. How much CO2 does a tower create? Well, let's find out. So let's just take one of the buildings at 300 meters, quite comparable to some of the buildings you're building here. So for, I'll just back that up. For a building that's made totally out of concrete, per volume of concrete, it's about 70,000 tons of CO2. But if we made the same volume of, out of timber, we'd save 80,000. And that is an aggregate of 150,000 tons of CO2. How much is that? Well, it's basically about 1,500 human lifetimes footprint of CO2. So that's quite big, but not really big enough. So the other thing that's interesting is that new calculations of how foundations are made or loaded have come to bear in Europe and in the UK. So when we build something anew, you only count 50% of the load-bearing capacity of the soil because the soil is yet to lose all its water because of the weight of the building. But after 10 years, you could basically double the height of the building if all else is possible within the building, because the foundations now can actually bear double the calculated amount. So what does that mean? It means you could double the height of all of the buildings you have here, but if you use timber, which is about a quarter the weight, you can add like 100 meters or so to the height of the building. And these studies have been done in Toronto for Four Seasons Hotel. So if you're trying to densify the city with a new type of material, it's an interesting material to consider. So let me just look at this equation. This is a bit of hypothetical for you. So when we look at the equation E and M, E is energy and M is mass, and C squared is constant. Let's look to see what happens when energy and mass are related. We get energy reducing CO2. We get a reduction in mass, which saves energy. We reduce mass and reduce CO2. So in a funny way, if you think of it, what this is really saying is that heavy materials may not be the way forward if we're trying to save energy. And in saving energy, we save CO2. When we look at design, we have six influencers, big data pools through AI, of course, the advancement of 5G, the Paris Accord, which determines how much CO2 we're trying to meet zero. And one of the things that should be understood is that we're growing as a population. Every 13 seconds, there's an additional one person that comes to the planet. There's also a change with the new people in the room. We'll call them millennials broadly. There's a new change in ethos. Over here, is what I grew up with in the 1950s and 60s and 70s. That was the future. That was considered where we were going. That was modernity. But for younger people today, they look to the image on the other side, which suggests something different: clean air, renewable resource, bright and healthy. When studies have been done of using this new material, we're not talking about timber, we're talking about something called engineered mass timber, and one of the forms of it comes in is called CLT. Now, CLT is made of a series of small planks that are set one against the other in layers. So one layer, second layer is rotated, the next layer is rotated, so you get a cross lamination, and that means that the material is very much stronger and much more resilient and much more common in the sense that you can calculate it to a higher degree with accuracy. When we look at cities, we also look at how people move, how they use the resources within the city, not just within a day, but within a week. So we see it as a living place, a place where changes are intended and good. We've done buildings, of course, this is Sky Central, media broadcaster. And of course, here we've used timber, but the notion here is that we're creating movement through the day so that there's a life flow, as if this were a village, through the buildings. We're doing a number of timber buildings as studies and constructions, but one of the things we're trying not to do is hybrid buildings, where buildings are made principally of concrete, masquerading as timber towers, which is Hoho is a good example. About 60% of the building actually is concrete. All the stability system is concrete. There are ring beams that exist on the building that hold up planks of timber that are then topped with concrete. When we're looking at these buildings, because this is a theoretical proposal, we're looking at the benefits of using just the timber for stability. And that's quite important to know, because it changes your CO2 footprint. This is a good example that is completed in Norway, called Tret, and in talking with the fellows who designed this, they were also looking at creating taller towers, double the height. And so we've taken Tret as our basis, working with Cambridge University, and looked at a whole range of different buildings over time, over the past 4 years. We should understand that what we're doing is at a very nascent stage. So here is a building from 1885, made out of steel. And of course, it's only 55 meters, but again, in 45 years, they were already up to about 300, 400 meters. That's the Empire State Building. So that's where we're at. We're really at this low level, looking at 120-meter towers. But of course, you know, in 50 years, perhaps we're going to be as tall as some of the buildings as exist here today. Here are some of the images of some of the projects. I'll do this very quickly. This is the comparison. Both of these projects are being done with Cambridge University, the one in Chicago and the one in London, which is Oakwood Timber Tower 1. Again, the planned form of Timber Tower 1 is a series of bundled structural elements that rise very much like the Willis Tower or the old Sears Tower in Chicago, based on Russian constructivist notions of how buildings should be built and constructed. So we have lots of timber in Canada, in Europe, that could be used, and it could house about a billion people in a lifetime. So we've been well published. That was another part of the proposal, to see what the media, how it would be adopted, and how people would feel about the idea of living in timber towers or living in timber buildings properly. And I've got to say, at least in Europe and North America and Australia, they love the idea because it's a natural material. And because we've got this engineered methodology, quite similar to creating carbon fiber shells, we have got a lot of strength out of the material and it can do new things. These are just some of the particulars about the engineering faculties in Europe.
We've probably all daydreamed at some point about what life will be like in the future. Whether you're optimistic, shimmering cities, hoverboards and robot assistants, or pessimistic, pollution, 3D advertising, robot overlords, Well, the future won't be quite like any of those. It will be dominated by challenges such as climate change, the ever-increasing population, and artificial intelligence.
This is Oakwood Timber Tower 1 at the Barbican. It's 315 meters. This would be, if constructed, the tallest building in London.
Production and use of concrete amounts to something like 8% of global greenhouse gas emissions. And if concrete were a country, it would be something like the third emitter in the world. Timber is the only building material that we can grow at a large scale and is genuinely our only renewable resource as long as we use timber that comes from sustainably managed forests in a responsible way.
Wood is an ancient building material and we have worked with it for a long, long time. Therefore, in some ways, it is a repackaged material, but it is also a newer and advanced material for cutting-edge applications into high-rise timber, for instance.
So what we're doing here is we're using traditional woods such as spruce and beech, and we are engineering those timbers, cutting them up and gluing them back together. In doing so, we're creating much larger elements of timber. It's a mix of new fabrication techniques and a better understanding of timber now that has enabled us to start thinking about building much taller buildings in timber. So, for example, what we have here is something called cross-laminated timber. And what we've got is spruce planks that have been layered up in 3, 5, and 7 layers. And each time we put a new layer on, we turn the spruce through 90 degrees. So we start stacking these pieces of timber together. And by doing that, that creates a very dimensionally stable product that we can use in very tall buildings.
The first worry people always have with timber, with wood, is that it burns, and of course it does. But the way it burns is quite well understood and can be easily controlled.
The burning of timber, the process of it, produces a char layer. And this char layer itself is highly insulative and acts as a thermal barrier to the source of the fire.
Modern building systems with their fire escape routes and their capacity studies and their sprinkler systems are really easily made safe for wood as much as they are for steel or concrete.
For an architect, of course, we're designers. So when we see a new material, we envision a new type and appearance of building, a new way that the material is to be used.
My project is focusing on a building in Chicago called River Beach Tower. It's entirely a timber design. It's composed of CLT, LVL, and glulam, which are all innovative engineered wood. Duplex units, sort of prefabricated duplex units, come along by barge, and then they are stacked to create the tower. So you sort of stack module on module. And then through the middle, you have this glass atrium, which has got all the light and sort of open green space.
So these are trees that are planted as crops with the intention to cut them down, just like wheat or hay. The trees sequester carbon as they grow, and then that carbon gets put into buildings.
When we discuss buildings, we say you're going to double the number of residential requirements that you'll have in the world. Why not use this material? Because it goes negative. It basically absorbs CO2. So by example, there's a new building that's just going up, not yet completed in London. For that very large building, in concrete, it has a footprint of about 70,000 tons of CO2. But if it were out of timber, it would be a minus 80,000 tons of CO2.
We have a natural affinity for wood. We surround ourselves with it.
Timber has a very strong emotional and psychological effect on people. Their heart rates go down, people become more sociable, and your brain capacity apparently increases, which I'm really, you know, happy to hear.
I don't know the scientific answer of why it makes us feel good, but it does.
You now have this material which retains a sort of the aesthetic quality and the well-being quality. People enjoy being in a wooden building. But now with engineered wood, you have all these structural properties that it can compete with things like steel or concrete and be used in skyscraper design. And so I think the benefits of that are huge.
Okay, another video.
Our population globally is growing, and our urban population is also growing rapidly, and so we need to find ways to build cities more sustainably for growing populations.
In the next 30 years, about 150 major cities in the world will double in terms of their urban population. What is going to happen will be really a residential need that will be almost catastrophic in scale unless we find a new way of building.
Architects can no longer ignore the responsibility they have towards choosing more eco-friendly materials or sustainable materials. What we are trying to do is we're trying to show that it is indeed possible to build structures that are architecturally interesting using natural materials.
So Oakwood Timber Towers began as a first project as we were invited by Cambridge University and Smith and Walworth engineers. They were interested in a tower of about 100 meters for study, but when we were discussing as a group, we thought, why not just simply go to the maximum, which is 300 meters.
Building with wood, engineered wood at the scale of skyscrapers, is the first time we've had a new large-scale structural building material in over 150 years since structural steel and reinforced concrete. We know that global carbon emissions need to come down, and building with wood is an excellent alternative to building with steel or concrete.
What we're really beginning to find, though, is that it's a new method of construction that really has the opportunity to change the industry and bring us into the 21st century, unlike any other material.
CLT is an abbreviation for cross-laminated timber. It's wood glue, so they're 90 degree different. Glued together, you get very large panels that architects and engineers currently use more or less like slabs of concrete. There are lots of advantages to using cross-laminated timber. Among them, it sequesters carbon from the forest. It is an engineered material, so it's the same every time you ask for it. It's usually cut and pre-manufactured in a factory, so it comes to site ready to assemble. It's very light, particularly compared to steel and concrete, so you can get taller buildings on the same sized foundations. And we hear a lot about the change that would be possible to global carbon emissions if all people became vegetarian. I think we can make an argument that cities ought to be vegetarian. When we talk about timber buildings, the three most common questions are of fire, forests, and rotting. Wood is combustible and it will burn, but the type of wood that we're using in these very large-scale skyscrapers is different. So these solid wood panels they behave much more like trunks of trees. So as the wood burns, the charcoal is very insulating, so it protects the unburned wood underneath. The goal is that if you remove the source of heat, the fire will go out. The Center for Natural Material Innovation at Cambridge University is located in the Architecture Department. It's funded by the Leverhulme Trust, and it brings together biochemists, plant scientists, architects, engineers, chemists, and mathematicians to try and find ways to use plant materials at a larger scale in the built environment.
So I'm Paul Dupre, I'm in the Department of Biochemistry in the University of Cambridge, and I work on the structure of wood. Well, there are several reasons why wood is so strong. There are three main parts to wood: the cellulose, xylan, and lignin, and it's not been understood how they stick together to make this remarkable material. And the shape of the xylan molecule, it has evolved, we presume, to be precisely complementary to the surface of the cellulose fibers. So when they come close to each other, they're able to zip up like two parts of a zip, and that brings the whole molecular structure together and makes it remarkably strong. And we might be able to use that knowledge to improve the properties of wood, perhaps by finding components that we can put in the wood to preserve it or change its structural properties.
When you build a tall building, you have to be very conscious of how they will respond to lateral wind loading on the side, because they, even though they're big, stiff, huge structures, they will still flex about to some extent in the wind. One of the challenges with timber buildings is that a skyscraper built out of timber really will be lighter than it would have been in concrete or steel. And that means that they are more susceptible to moving around in the wind, to vibrating, which could make occupants uncomfortable. So we need to mitigate this and understand how to design appropriately in timber versus in other materials.
Most failures lie in connections. Could be either for concrete buildings or even for timber buildings. So we need to make sure that we provide safe, reliable and robust connections in any case. And this is where research is needed, especially when we need to address higher limits, for example, in tall buildings. So the different colors is a visualization of the magnitude of the stresses. Usually red color indicates higher stresses, usually at the lowest levels of the building, whereas blue can indicate smaller stresses.
We work on small molecule compounds that can penetrate into the extremely tiny pores inside of large timber. We are all made up of extremely small polymers and even smaller molecules, right? Our DNA, our proteins. And so you can say that we can engage and interact on the human scale, but of course what's happening are many processes at a much, much tinier scale. And in the same way, the buildings of the future may be held together through rapid interactions that are happening at the molecular level, but having a macroscopic effect on the human scale. And perhaps in the future, we'll be able to completely remove the concept of a nail or a screw holding two timber joints together. Perhaps they can all be done through small molecules that come together at very specific interfaces and give the wood unbelievable strength.
We have to ensure that wooden buildings of the future, even wooden buildings today, are made from sustainably managed forests. Deforestation is a big problem in forests around the world, but it is usually a result of cutting forests for agriculture rather than cutting forests for building materials. The sustainable forests, which are not subject to deforestation, are planted as crops. In Europe, in the last few decades, the sustainable harvest has grown by an area the size of Portugal. The amount that can be harvested, that hasn't actually been harvested. So the forests are larger by a tremendous amount.
There's a new science called biophilia, and incorporating timber into cities will improve the sense of nature returning to human habitations, to cities particularly. So there's a very strong connection psychologically. Our heart rates are reduced. We're less stressed, which is something you want in a city center. We become more sociable, therefore, apparently. So we see enormous benefits in using the material.
So I can imagine a future where we're growing our buildings, where we live in a building that's been made from a tree that was cut down not too far away, and when that tree was cut down, two were planted in its place. From the first skyscraper in 1885, it was less than 50 years that we got to 381 meters of the Empire State Building. In the near future, we will see taller and taller wooden buildings, and it will be common for us to accept them, and that we will see some wooden skyscrapers on the skyline of London, New York, other great cities in the world.
The group's research on timber towers not only pushes the limits of architectural design, structural engineering, and scientific research, but it also synthesizes them. We hope to solve a host of problems that can trickle down to other building typologies by showing that the very limit of engineering can be achieved using timber as a natural material.
Okay, if we built one of these timber towers, I've got to go very quickly. It's about 1,000 human lifetimes. But if we built 100, that's about 100,000 human lifetimes. And if we built 1,000 of these timber towers, that would be about 1,000,000. So we're making a little bit of a dent into the CO2 profile. And that's how you have to understand this material. In scale, it has an enormous benefit. We have the material. In Europe, bugs are eating more material per year than we're actually using. So it's beneficial in that sense. and we're giving the bugs a bit of a diet. And when we look at the material, of course, because our population is growing, our CO2 footprint would naturally increase. And so what we're saying is that this material, this building methodology, this material, if it's used properly, not as a hybrid, but all of its own, then we can reduce our carbon footprint significantly and go to zero as planned. There are two tracks, though, from this moment, for all you young people out there. We can do nothing, which I think would be a tragedy, and we can do something. And this is just showing the two different tracks. Frank Lloyd Wright, quite a famous engineer and architect, said that trees were a wonderful friend. Another video.
By 2050, the world's population is expected to soar to almost 10 billion people, and two-thirds of us will live in cities. Space will be at a premium. High-rise offers a solution, but concrete and steel, the materials we currently use to build high, have a large carbon footprint. An answer might lie in a natural material we've used for millennia.
I think it's very realistic to think that someone will build a wooden skyscraper in the coming years. There's a lot of potential that's unrealized for using timber at a very large scale.
Throughout history, buildings have been made of wood. So why, after more than a century of concrete and steel, are some architects proposing a return to wood? Concrete and steel are costly to produce and heavy to transport. Wood, however, can be grown sustainably, and it's lighter than concrete. And crucially, as trees grow, they absorb carbon dioxide from the air, locking it into the timber. One study showed that using wood to construct a 125-meter skyscraper could reduce the building's carbon footprint by up to 75%. Regular timber isn't malleable like steel or concrete, and it isn't strong enough to build high. But engineers have come up with a solution. It's called cross-laminated timber. And this London practice is not alone in advocating the use of CLT. Ambitious wooden high-rise buildings are also being constructed in Scandinavia, Central Europe, and North America. As yet, nobody has used CLT to build beyond 55 meters. But Michael Ramage's research center in Cambridge, working with another London practice, has proposed a concept design of a 300-meter tower to be built on top of one of London's most iconic concrete structures, the Barbican.
The way we've engineered the Oakwood Tower is to look at the global structure, and is it stable and would it stand up? And we believe the answer is yes. I think we'll probably see incremental increases from the current height of about 50 meters. And at some point, someone will make a step change, probably to about 100 meters.
Making that jump in height will be a difficult sell. The cost of building wooden skyscrapers is largely unknown, but those costs could be reduced by prefabricating large sections of buildings in factories. And city dwellers will need to be persuaded that CLT does not burn like ordinary wood. As an attractive natural material, wood is already popular for use in low buildings. If planners approve, it could rise to new heights.
So we can save 30%, 40% less waste. The scale benefits I mentioned, if we had 1,000, it would be 1 million people. We studied several high-rise buildings. The material is very good in terms of its profile. It's as strong as timber, as concrete and steel by weight, but it's about a quarter of the weight. And it takes about a quarter of the time to build in urban centers, as we found in London projects. You've seen that slide. It takes about 120 minutes, of about the time this lecture is going to end, to build a building. So it's a great material. We did this study in order to see what would be the potential on a real site. We did what architects do, get inspired by adjacent buildings, by Wren, St. Paul's particularly with its four piers. And the notion really is that we take a courtyard, an urban courtyard, and allow the building to grow within it. At the tops, for weight reasons, for balance, we've added gardens. And you can see these. I'm going through these very quickly. And these can all be found online in our website. The interesting thing is that it's such a light material and so strong, it's ideal for precision cutting that you'd use if you were making pre-assembled factory elements that are brought to site. And robotics are an ideal forum for this material because of its precision, much more precise than steel, for certain, and concrete. So that's Oakwood Timber Tower 1. Okay, we're going to the home stretch now. So we're in the media, a lot of press, Japanese books, got a high-rise award, not just for this material, but any design. Then our client asked us to look into timber for a building that he had in the capital of Holland, in the Netherlands. And I'll just go through these slides very quickly. It was a very, very narrow, narrow site. And the limit of height was about 80 meters, but because he was able to convince the city fathers that the material would be new and provide a new impetus for a green movement in construction in Holland, they were allowed to go up to 120 meters. So what that really means is that his profit doubled by advocating this material. And they'll be constructed, I'm almost finished. What was interesting with the material too is that the exterior skin acted as shading for the sun. And you saw some of these slides early on the video, some of the testing, the lobbies. And again, this is on at exhibition in two different locations in the city. All made from straight elements. Okay, designed as a basket weave. Oakwood Timber Tower 3, almost finished, you guys, so don't go negative. We're talking about 1,000. Now, we had a client, we'll just say it's hypothetical, who came to us who has got 50,000 sites throughout the world in major urban centers. And what we're imagining is that we can build one of these towers in each of these locations, as the fuel, fossil fuel that they're using presently is going to eventually go to electricity, as it's doing in Europe slowly, we imagine that's about 30 million lifetimes of CO2 footprint that can be saved. Here are the images, 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 images. Very quick video. Okay, Timber Tower 4, I'll just show you an image of something we're proposing in Europe, and that gives you a flavor. It's as if they were wood planks that were stacked. Now, the benefits are derived from wood. Well, one of them is that a whole new industry could be created derived from wood and the byproducts of fossil or fuels, of jet fuel as one, and it was mentioned plastics, but in fact, plastics could all be made from lignin, and that's being studied at present. There are great benefits, though, in thinking of the construction industry as integrated into AI. You probably know the construction industry is the least innovative of any industry the world has ever known. And part of the reason is that they have methodology that's fixed by the material. The material is 2,500 years old. The Greeks invented it. It was perfected to some degree by the Romans. And it takes some time to cure. In fact, when you think of high-rise buildings, you're making shuttering to hold the concrete. That's, and the shuttering is typically wood or wood derived. And you're stacking and building the building once to allow for a plate, a tray, that can then hold the concrete, very heavy material, with its steel rods and allow it to cure. Then you break the foundation, the shuttering, and then that gets thrown away as a massive waste. Well, why are we putting concrete there? Why aren't we using the material of the wood as it is presently without adding the concrete? Concrete is one-third of the weight, actually, is just simply to hold itself up, okay? So you have a material that is great to build bomb shelters, but not so good for building economically. Your housing could be half the price and built in a third of the time if it was made out of timber in high-rise design. Even presently. So these are some of the benefits taken from McKinsey, and this is an article that's mentioned by Katera, that there's huge benefits in integrating a material with AI and blockchain and other advanced building methodologies that are coming to the fore. So let's advance. Innovation in Toronto, they've adopted this. Of course, Google has the money to do this. And they're the master plan for all the buildings they're building. Thank you very much. Any questions? Anybody put up your hand right there.
Is it all timber? Or is there
anything? It's all timber. What we're doing, because we're doing with the university, this is a hypothetical project to some degree. We're testing the material. This is going to take us years to perfect. For the second tower, which is the oval one, it's about 120 meters. We could build it in a year's time after further study. But they're real projects, they're all timber, there's no concrete, because with concrete we learn nothing about the mastery of the material for the load-bearing capacity. As you go higher to around 200 meters, towers, the dead load of the towers are not the problem, it's the wind, the torsional movement. And tests today from Cambridge show that they can't use the concrete or steel tables that engineers usually use. You need to create a whole new school of engineering to use this material. What? And you need new contractors because they're unfamiliar with this material.
What about wet area?
Sorry, wet?
Wet areas.
Well, we're trying to keep the... Well, wet, okay, wet areas. Well, there's all timber. Have you... Yes, all of it, all of it, all of it. Yeah, yeah, all of it, yeah, yeah. When they did TRET, they just made boxes. They put in boxes like shoe boxes into trays.
Is there going to be any long-term effects on the, if you keep wet the area?
No. Yeah. What is great with the timber is that it manages is the humidity. So what WSP and engineer have put on a slide to say, that actually you need less mechanical systems to manage the air quality because the timber, if exposed, has a natural ability to absorb extra moisture. And also, it has its own ability to take care of fungus. So that's what they say. They're engineers, global engineers, I believe them. But again, this is nascent stage. We're at early stage of looking at this material, and there's a long way to go. But in 400 meters, maybe in 10 or 15 years, you're going to see all your buildings out of timber.
So it is 100% made of timber?
Yes. That's what we're studying. And the order and the reason is that, first of all, the carbon footprint, if we made half of it or 60% out of concrete, we'd make no benefit. If we clad it all out of, you know, concrete panels on the exterior, that we'd have very little benefit. If we made it all out of brick on the exterior, it'd have little benefit. So we're looking at all timber, because that's what we're doing. It's a study. We're trying to advance and look at this as vigorously as you can. You can see it's very collaborative. There are other universities involved, and we're changing the codes around the world in order to accommodate the use of this new material called engineered mass timber. So this is not wood. This is a new material with its own code, its own fire standards, everything.
Termites.
Okay, I used to work on projects in Bangkok, and I was mentioning there they could only build out of teak because the bugs would just eat everything. So yeah, that's a problem. In this environment, you're going to have to use the material and engineer it to move away from any of these or mitigate any of these problems that you might encounter. It's a natural process of choosing material. If you use the typical thing is if you have a tower about 200 meters in steel or concrete, over 200 meters, the most efficient structural system is to make all of the exterior elements, the load-bearing elements. But with this timber, because of its particulars, it's very good in compression, extremely good in compression, surprisingly so, but not very good in tension. So what we needed to do is to make sure that the member sizes, but also their positionings, had its greatest benefit, not for the dead loading, but for the torsional loading. In Canada, the government, because it's a place with a lot of timber, and it has a navigation history, so they think of timber as something that floats rather than burns, they think of timber as something that's safe. So they're much more able to understand timber buildings for high rises as something that's good. So at Google, they're building 150 buildings, you know, over 100 meters. And that's why I showed that slide. Are we destroying natural habitats by using this material? What we see in North America, particularly Canada, is there are a lot of managed forests. In other words, they're forests that have been planted specifically for the use of industry. The industry at that time was pulp and paper. Many, many people read the New York Times all out of pulp and paper, but now they're reading it on their Kindles or they're reading it on their iPads. So the pulp and paper industry, the forestry industry in Canada and the States is moribund. The factories are closing, closing, closing. Unemployment is high, high, high. And this could generate new jobs, good jobs that allow new skill and new technology to be developed that can then be patented and sent around the world. So the forests in Canada, very, very, very many of them, you think they're wildernesses, they typically have all already been cut down once by the British for their naval, for naval reasons, and for shipbuilding, have the benefit of locking in a lot of CO2. There are a lot of, and I'm a believer in technology. I believe that if this material is important to many people societally, they will make sure that the forests are better served, serve the animals, and create biodiversity as they do not typically do now. So once this becomes an important source for many things, we're talking about bottles and plastics and glass, and building construction materials and glues, and it can have a huge impact to the benefit of everyone and to the forests and the animals living in them. You probably know that there's, you know, the way that we cut down forests now is not terribly good. Typically, the best way is to do checkerboarding. but still that is a, creating a monoculture of trees is not so terrific.
Mr. Flanagan? Sorry to interrupt.
So am I finished? Is lunch already gone?
Yeah.
There's some wood sandwiches outside if you're looking for them. And,
but if
you have questions, just come to the front.
All right, now, thank you, Mr. Flanagan, for sharing with us on timber structures.